All right. Well, thank you for having me. And this is a great mini meeting of all kinds of interesting science and activities in the various parks. So today I want to talk about some of those rocks that are sitting above the water of Lake Chelan and then going up into the North Cascades National Park and up around Highway 20. And all of those rocks are really a lot of the magmatism that formed due to an ancient subduction zone. And this is work with a couple of other co-authors, Michael Eddy at Purdue and Robert Miller at San Jose State, and all through funding from the National Science Foundation. Next slide, please. So just to give you oriented, here's a cartoon just thinking about how we know that the surface of the Earth is divided into tectonic plates, and we've heard a lot about the Cascadia subduction zone today. And what we're talking about in the rocks that we're studying is an ancient subduction zone. So in this cartoon cross-section looking into the Earth, on the right side of it, it says lithosphere going down, and that lithosphere going down causes magmatism that rises up, and you can see the formation of the volcano there in that overriding plate. And so those volcanoes are similar to things like Mount Rainier, Mount St. Helens that we have active today. But in the past, we had a lot of active subduction as well. And what we have evidence of for that past subduction is magmatism that was down in the deep crust, but is now up at the surface and has been brought to the surface via erosion and faulting. And so we see evidence of that all along Western North America. Next slide, please. And so here's a simplified geologic map of the entire part of Western North America. And what I want you to focus in on the map is that kind of purplish, pinkish color that has the crosshatch through it. And you see these bodies of that purple rock going all the way from up into the Yukon down into Mexico. And all of these represent igneous rock suites that we call batholiths. And so they're just large crystallized magma bodies, and these magmas and the associated volcanic arcs that were active from around 220 to 45 million years ago. And then due to the erosion and faulting, they've been brought up to the surface. So all of these areas represent really excellent windows into the deep roots of volcanic arcs. And so we've been studying one of these within the North Cascades. And you can see, if you look in northwestern Washington, a box there that we're going to zoom in onto next. Next slide, please. And so here's another simplified geologic map. What we're studying is what we call the crystalline core of the arc. And so this represents a variety of igneous and metamorphic rocks that were once about 40 kilometers below the surface that have been now brought up over time. And they're bounded by two major fault systems that are no longer active, but were active in the geologic past. And these are represented by the black lines of the Straight Creek Fault in the west, and then the Ross Lake fault zone that runs northwest, southeast, and all the rocks in between there and the kind of pinks to reds to purples are what we call high-grade metamorphic rocks. And then in the white with the dash symbols are the igneous rocks. Outside of those fault systems are sedimentary rocks. And so you have a major discontinuity in terms of kind of the types of rocks going across those fault systems. And so in the middle of that, in that crystalline core, is kind of that window into the deep crust and rocks that are representative of magmatism active from 90 to 45 million years ago. And just to give you a sense of these rocks, I'll show a couple of pictures over the next slides. So next slide, please. So here's an example of one of the metamorphic rocks. Most of these are started out life as sediments that then once pushed down deep into the earth were exposed to high pressures and temperatures that cook them and turn them into these metamorphic rocks. And so here's an example of one of them where the darker minerals within there are biotite, the darker kind of little dotted guys that you can see throughout the photograph are garnet. And so these metamorphic rocks were the host rocks to the arc magmatism, meaning that they were the rocks that were there that the magmas intruded into. And then some of them also actually were sediment that were incorporated into the arc during active magmatism. Next slide, please. And so here's a cartoon cross section to give an example of how we get that sediment into the deep crust. So on the y-axis is a variety of depths in kilometers. And so if you look into the right where it says NC arc, this would be the equivalent of kind of the volcano sitting up on the surface. And then the white bulbous shapes are the magmas that are down deep in the crust. And so we think what happens is that you get so much magmatism into the crust that it heats it up quite significantly because that magma is bringing lots of heat. And so that causes the crust to weaken. And that combined with this being an overall convergent plate tectonic setting allows some of the sediment that's sitting to the west of the arc and that forearc and the orange and the pinks to then be pushed into the deep levels of the arc. And then that sediment gets heated up and metamorphosed to become our metamorphic rocks that we see within the core today. And you can see a lot of these excellent metamorphic rocks exposed along Highway 20 if you're going into the national park. Next slide, please. And then the other main rock type that most people think of with arc settings are the igneous rocks, the magmatic rocks. And so here's a picture from near Washington Pass along Highway 20, looking at all of the mountains within this picture are from one magmatic event that's called the Golden Horn Batholith. And so this intruded around 47 million years ago. And so it was a huge volume of magmatism that was emplaced into the crust. And then the upper right is just kind of a more in-depth image of what those rocks look like if you're standing right in front of them. Next slide, please. And so what we found, and a lot of what we've been doing, is uranium lead radiometric dating, so we can figure out when these magmas were intruding into the crust. And so here's a compilation of a lot of the dates that we've collected. And so in the graph here, it has the age in millions of years along the x-axis, and then the y-axis is the magmatic area, so how much magma is being intruded. And what we find is that the magmatic or the emplacement of the magma is not continuous, and that it comes in these pulses that people call flare-up events. And we're not the only ones to recognize this. Many others have seen this in other places around the world. And so what we see for the North Cascades is that there's a big pulse of magmatism at the beginning of the subduction event from around 95 to 85 MA. Then there's a smaller event from 75 down to around 60 million years ago. And then a final big pulse of magmatism from around 50 to 45 million years. And the youngest event there, that 50 to 45 million year old window, has kind of an unusual history to it. Next slide, please. And so during that time, the plate margin had kind of a complex history. And so on the left here is just kind of a sketch map of the plate margin, where the lighter gray would be the continent, and then the black line that has the major line with the tooth marks on it, that was the subduction zone boundary. And around 50 million years ago, there's another kind of boundary that is intersecting with the margin. That's the thicker black line that's separating the Yakutat from the Silesia. And so that's a spreading margin, a seafloor spreading. And so if you look at the cartoon on the right, they're trying to show what happens potentially where you have the seafloor spreading and a mantle plume interacting with it. And so that plume comes up and is able to reach up to the surface and build up a lot of magmatism right at that spreading center that creates what we call an oceanic plateau. So a big welt of mafic igneous rocks. And so an analog to that today is Iceland. And so when you try to subduct that big, hot, buoyant mass, that's what we call Silesia over on the left image, it doesn't want to subduct. So next slide, please. And so now here's kind of stepping back to a larger image to show you where Silesia collided into the margin in that subduction zone. So it's now exposed in parts of Oregon and also in Washington. And so what happens when that plateau slides in is it doesn't want to subduct. And so it actually causes the subducting slab to tear and part of it to break off. And so that's what's shown in the cartoon on the right. And that allows a lot of magma from the mantle to come up to create the big volumes of magma that we see in that third flare-up event in the Cascades core. Next slide, please. So what we're focused now on working on after kind of working through that younger story is exactly what caused the magmatism that we see in this flare-up number two event from 75 to 65 MA. Next slide. And one of the goals is to really tie in that magmatism into the other processes happening within the core. And so here's a couple of different cartoon cross sections and block diagrams going into the core to think about how we need to look at what's happening in the really deep crust. So on the left, where it's labeled Swakane and Skagit gneiss, that would be the deeper rocks, to how that's linked into the upper crust where we have basins forming, as well as how those injections of magma and metamorphism affect the fault systems that bound there. And so we're thinking about these rocks at kind of all different structural levels. And so just one more slide to wrap up, please. And one of the main goals with all of this is that, you know, with the North Cascades and these other areas where we have these deep rocks exhumed at the surface, is we can use these ancient rocks to understand what's happening in the deep crust and apply it to places where we still have active magmatism, like in the Andes in South America, because there you don't have those deep rocks exhumed at the surface. And so we can use kind of studies of ancient systems to better understand the active systems that we have today. So thank you.
All right. Thank you, Stacia. And are there any questions? I didn't see anything in the chat. So if you have any questions, you can raise your hand or you can put it in the chat.
All right. I know it's not as exciting as earthquakes and stuff, but we do love our rocks.
Still really cool research.
Thanks.
Kind of blown away by the amount of I'm a geologist in Mount Rainier, and I had no idea that a lot of this stuff that was going on. So this is really exciting to see this going on.
Thank you.
Okay. There are any questions, you can put them in the chat. We might have some time at the end too. If you think of any questions that we've had, there we go. We got a question that just came in from Carl. Metasediments represent four arc that was thrust under the arc, but not part of the accretionary wedge at the subduction zone. Can you provide modern analog for what you interpret as happening in the North Cascades?
Yeah, this is something we really struggled with as to where those sediments are coming from, because you did mention the accretionary wedge, and it is possible that they are accretionary wedge rocks as well. But most people think that if it was accretionary wedge, that the slab would have to actually kind of flatten its angle as it's subducting to kind of bulldoze those accretionary rocks directly into the arc. And we don't have any evidence that the slab angle changed through time. I don't actually have a modern example of where that's happening. I think it would be really hard to document because you'd have to look at the seismological record to see that. And I'm not sure if we'd have the record for that. And so this is really something that we're just starting to see more in this ancient record, that this is a process that's happening and through the record of kind of tracking these deep rocks. And so now it's been documented in the North Cascades, and people also observe it in the Sierra Nevada mountains to the south, where there's this quote sediment incorporation events.
Excellent.